sensitive to it. Now we have come to the place that you have to learn to depend more on heaven than earth. And I want you to pray for grace to depend on heaven. Because when you come to the place in a generation where you start hearing things you don't want to hear and seeing things you don't want to see, what I mean is that it looks like everything in our generation is fighting our faith, which is a requirement to please God. Come alive, Geneva. I said everything is fighting your faith. Especially those of you in this part of the world. I told you can go to the office, about 50 workers, and you are the only Christian. That means that the unrest of the 49 is against you. The sad thing is that even pastors are fighting pastors.
Everywhere.
So, tell your neighbor the fight is on. Tell the person the fight. Amen. Everything is fighting. Everything is trying to bring you to the place of discouragement. Everything is contending. And so, you cannot... Let me say something, whether you are paying your theology a little bit. Do you know that you need a stronger faith than Peter, who walked with Jesus? Let me show you the difference. The difference between you and Peter is that the Jesus Peter trusted, he ate with him. She saw him. Jesus even washed his feet. Some of you are praying that Jesus, show me your finger. He has never appeared. Now, get the difference. So the difference between us, Peter, is that we are serving a Jesus we have never seen. And we still have to believe and trust he's around. So look at the way they wrote. Look at what John wrote. What we have seen with our eyes. But it cannot work for us. So you need a stronger faith than Peter. The most difficult aspect of me and you, our Christian life, is that we believe something we can't see. However, you can also doubt what you see. Oh, come on here. I pray. I told you I'm going to say very strong things. You can't doubt what you see. And we are also trying to believe something we cannot see or we have never seen. You need a greater grace. Amen. Now pray a simple prayer. There's a man who came and said, Jesus, help down my unbelief. Then Peter also, when he talks about them forgiving people 77 times 7, they say, then increase our faith. Lift your hand and say, Lord, increase my faith. Ask for grace. Open your mouth and pray that prayer. Lord, increase my faith. Pray that prayer, Geneva.
Rapanda kapenda la bosha da kapa ratenda la bade bosha bada bada ba rapanda
bosha di ba ya tusa
e kompela bela bosha danda la ba ya pali bri ya pa ya pa 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 rapanda da pa ya koda ba kapa rapada kapa rataba kapa da la bosha.
That is why Jesus told Simon that, Simon, Simon, Satan has desired to have you, that he may sift you as wheat, but I've prayed for you. Not that you won't go through the attack. Not that the attack will be reversed. The attack is necessary for promotion. You are coming alive tomorrow, tomorrow. When you get there, I'll tell you. Tell your neighbor, the attack is necessary for your promotion. Tell them. If it doesn't mind, you look at another person and say that you need attack. You need it.
You need attack. You need attack.
How many of you believe that? Amen. I'm going to show you the difficult aspect of your operation of faith. Everything is faith is fine until it's tested. So there are some of you here, you are in the stage of the testing of the faith. Whether it's ministry or marriage or children or that, every faith, step of faith must be tested. And that is where, if you are not careful, you lose the faith. The testing. And some people, they don't know it's being tested. When you don't know your faith is being tested, you start blaming it on people. Yeah. That is why Paul said that your battle is not flesh and blood.
Yeah.
No. It's not flesh and blood. It's not flesh and blood. Look at your neighbor and say, the way I look at your face, it's possible your faith is being tested. Tell the person. Say, the way you are standing there, brackete, like you are so... tell the person, I can see your faith is being tested. I can see. And let me tell you something. The package of the test is different with everybody. To some, the testing of your faith is that God will allow the devil to hit you with a sickness. To some, it's a disease. To some, it's a marriage. To some, it's disappointment. To some, living in a country without document. I like the response.
It's a common occurrence.
But within the test, there is a promotion. You just have to make sure you stand strong. Because you see, the step of the faith, some of you want to be promoted by God without the test. This is where you are. If you don't get tested and you get here, you can die. Because the spirit that will allow to come and test you when you are here will be stronger here than the ones here. That is why even God cannot give my test to you. No, what I can survive, it will mash you. And I have survived some dangerous things. Do you know that for you to escape the fear of death, you must face death?
Yeah.
I'm not talking about dream. You must face death face to face. When you walk with the Lord, in the light of His word, what a glory He sheds on our way,
while
as we do His good will, He abide with us. Do we have not been saying Geneva? Look at your neighbor and say, trust and obey, for there is no other way to be happy. Once a while, get the hymns, especially the Methodism book. And you don't sing it, just read it. You know, the folks that wrote Charles Wesley and John Wesley, the anointing on them to write the hymns is close to the anointing of people that wrote the Bible. Because the hymns are over 400 years and they are still alive. Some of you wrote a song last month. We are not singing it again. It's gone. It's dead. But you see, when you take the hymn as if it was written yesterday, I'm telling you, so for almost 500 years ago, those guys were seriously anointed. But you sometimes follow the words. When you walk with the Lord, that means that, listen, you cannot walk by faith when you are not walking with the Lord. These people are not serious. Let me try here and see. I said, the breakthrough starts when you make a decision to walk with the Lord. Some of you are not walking with the Lord. And let me mess your feeling a little bit. Some of us here, we are not working. No, did I say some of us? Some of you. I covered the first one with the blood of Jesus. I'm not part of it. Some of you, look at your neighbor and say, you. That is talking about you. You are not working with the Lord, though. You only come to look for God when there is a problem. Oh, man of God. Some of you try to find. So you don't mind God. What do you mean by you are not working with the Lord? I'll tell you some of the symptoms. When you wake up in the morning, prayer is not your priority. There are people you don't have a prayer life. When you see yourself coming, it means there's a problem. So you only come to God when there's a problem. Now, something is chasing you. Then you look for God and say, Lord, have you seen that thing chasing me? Do something about it. Then when God cleared the thing, then you pack God somewhere. But when you walk with the Lord in the light of his... Look at the way he's building up. In the light of his word, which is the authentic source of faith. That is where we draw faith from. That is where we draw faith from. That is the authentic source of faith. That is where we draw faith from. That is where faith cometh by hearing and hearing. In the light of his word. Am I teaching? Am I preaching this morning? In the light of his word. Not in the light of your feeling. Not in the light of what you see. Not in the light of what you feel. Not in the light of what the doctor is telling you. Thank God for the doctor's report. But I choose to believe the report of the Lord. In the light of his word. What a glory he shines on our way. Once we do his good will,
he abides with us still.
And with all who
trust and obey.
Now, he presents two keys to it, trust and obey. Now hear this. The greatest sin is not adultery. The greatest sin is not fornication. The greatest sin is disobedience. Within disobedience is adultery, fornication. What actually was the sin in the Garden of Eden? How many of you have ever thought that? Why did God put the tree of evil in the garden? How many of you have ever thought that? Lord, you shouldn't have put the tree there. How many of you ever thought that? Sincerely. Those of you who answer are down. You are the liars. You are the most liar. You have been thinking. How many of you have been thinking about that? Why did God put the tree there? Today, can I answer that question for you? The Lord just asked me to answer it for you. Let's start building it from this place. Do you know God created angels before he created man? How do you know that? They were what, there? Huh? Look at your neighbor and say, how do you know that? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Do you remember that scripture? Huh? So, it's very simple. That scripture can answer. In the beginning, God created the heavens. Everybody say the heavens. Another way you can call the heavens is the supernatural. Huh? Tell your neighbor the supernatural. God created the supernatural before he created the natural. And the angels don't live in the natural. But you let me answer it very well from direct from the Bible. God created angels before he created man. Angels sin before men sin. But the moment the angels sin, God prepared hell for them. 2 Peter chapter 2. Is it chapter 2 or chapter 4? Give me 2 Peter chapter 2. Let me see something from verse number 1. Is it Peter or Pira? 2 Peter chapter 2. As a virgin, I broke my virginity when I was 6 months old. I'm not too sure when, but I run the line. 6 months. Some of you know when you let's cover it with the blood. We won't talk about that one. Now, so because when you meet a woman for the first time, the hymns that break is part of the covenant. But unfortunately, thank God for Jesus. As for the grace, we have not exhausted it. Now, in a covenant, what did I say first? There must be what? And then a covenant. And all covenant must have terms. Because if there are no terms and conditions, then it's not a covenant. Then finally, every covenant must be sealed. So you see, this thing, it's not only in the Bible, but it's part of the covenant process. This is what sealed my covenant. Another word is called token. So you see, all the seven covenants in the Bible, the one that was not sealed, and is yet to be sealed, is the Adamic covenant. All the rest of the covenant was sealed. The Noahic covenant was sealed with the rainbow. So he said, by the seal of the rainbow, I will not destroy the earth. The Abrahamic covenant was sealed with circumcision. Oh, come on here. Come on. I have to keep going. Are you getting it? So all covenant must be sealed. Now watch this. So the moment you hear God say, be fruitful, you are going to multiply. You are going to replant. He's making promises. That means a covenant is being initiated. Now, in Genesis chapter 1, And verse number 18. Is it Genesis chapter 1, verse number 18? Give it to me. Watch this. Genesis chapter 1. Nana, the bringing of the scripture is very slow for me. Please, give me verse number 21. And God created the whales, 22. And blessed them, saying, be fruitful and multiply. And the waters. Where did God created the male and the female? 27. Thank you. Go to 27. 27. Now, so God created man in his own image. Huh? In the image of God created him. What? Everything you see here is not physical, it's spiritual. The male and the female is not a human being. It's spiritual. The actual handiwork was done in Genesis chapter 2. But let me give you something here. Let me see. Come, girl. Come. Come, sir. So this is what it is. Male and female. But in the first place, he put both of them in one body. If God didn't need Eve, a rib to create Eve, Adam. Then you need a rib to create Eve. Okay. What is actually the rib doing? But because it's a covenant, blood must be shed. So the cutting of Adam is the process of the covenant. Need a stronger. So he put Eve in Adam and cut Adam. He didn't need rape. So you don't. What is actually the rape? What did he do? No. It's a blood that must come out. So when he pulled the blood and he cut Adam, then Adam, he said that he took Eve from Adam. But in the spirit, he started and said, male and female created Eden. The male and the female, they are the spiritual side of you. And this one, they don't have gender. It is a physical one that has gender. In the spiritual realm, there's no gender. That is why you don't have male and female angels. So those of you who are trying to hire people to marry them in heaven, you are making the greatest mistake of them. Look at your neighbor and say, marry me now, because in heaven you can't see me. There's no gender. That's why Jesus said that they will become like the angels. Sit down. Are you getting the picture? Now we are answering the question here. Are you enjoying the morning session? You enjoy more than the evening. The evening session is power, power. This one is teaching. Now watch this. So, male and female created Eden. Then he cut Adam. So two sides of the covenant has come. The promise has been made. The blood has been shed. Now the terms. So now you understand why he put the tree there. Because there can never be authentic obedience without opportunity for disobedience. Oh, come on here. You have to give the man a clap. Are you getting? How will God know that you believe him? So there can never be authentic obedience. So part of the covenant is that the terms is that you can eat all the fruit, but don't touch this. Because I'm in a covenant. Now you see that all this thing they play, he didn't do it with angels. That is why even the angels are shocked who we are. David came and said that, what is man that you are mindful of him? Is a son of man. He said, you have made him a little lower than nothing. You say Elohim than he himself. Because listen, sometimes all God manifests in the form of angel. Like Genesis chapter 17. When you see, sometimes God comes down in the form of angel. It is called theophany, the manifestation of Christ before he came to die. Few times in the Bible. One of them was like Jericho. Joshua chapter 5. When they were going to fight Jericho, then the man was standing with a sword. And then he put the sword. And Joshua rushed to him and said, are you for us or our adversaries? And he said, remove your sand as the captain of the host of heaven. And Joshua worshipped him. Normally, if he's an angel, he will reject it. But once he received it, that means Elohim. Number two, did we not cast three people? Where is the fourth man? Nebuchadnezzar has opened and said, I see a fourth man whose countenance is like the sun. So all these are manifestations, but in Genesis chapter 17, that was the time he was going to promise Isaac. Now, it came to pass, Genesis chapter 17, Genesis chapter 17. And when Abraham was 90 years old, and now the Lord appeared. The Lord appeared. Who appeared? But let's see the way he appeared. Huh? And said unto him, I am the Almighty God, walk before me. And be thou perfect. Watch this. Keep going. And I will make my covenant between me and you, and I'll multiply thy seed exceedingly. Watch this. And Abraham fell on his face and blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. Go to Genesis chapter 18, verse 1. Let me see something. Genesis chapter 18, verse 1. Let me see something. So I'll show you the covenant. And the Lord appeared unto him in the place of Mamre, and he sat at the tent door. Who appeared? Let's see the appearance. And he sat at the tent door in the heat of the day. So Abraham was just getting fresh air. And look at what happened there. In the course of the fresh air, the Bible said, Jesus Christ, who is there? How can he sit at the computer and work on it? Sit there. And he lifted up his eyes and looked. And look, how many? Three men stood by him. And when he saw them, he ran to meet them from the tent door and bowed himself down to the ground. If they are angels, they will not take it. So actually, you see, boy, come. Man of God, he looks like God, isn't it? Come. You, no, you are too slim. Come. Stand here. So you see, God doesn't walk alone. He was walking with two bodyguards. He lifted up his eye and looked. Three men stood by him, and when he saw them, he ran to meet them. So God in the middle and two angels. I'm going to show you. You know, you are quiet, you are confused. Let's get it. So three men. He ran to meet them from the tent door and bowed himself to the ground. Worship. Now, let's keep going. Watch this. Let a little water, I pray you, be fetched, and wash your feet. And rest yourself under the tree. Watch this. This time God was coming to do investigation. She was under serious investigation. And he passed through Abraham's house. She was on his way to Sodom. Now listen to what. I will fetch a morsel of bread and comfort you in your heart. After that you shall pass on. For therefore ye are come to your servant. And they said, so do as thou hast said. Abraham is a very sensitive man. God appeared in the form of man. Abraham could tell this are not normal people. And he dragged them into his house. Are you getting the picture now? So don't forget this picture. God, three angels, sit down. Man of God, thank you. Watch this. Now, so Abraham forced them that I want to fetch water. I want to prepare cake for you. Huh? This is what Paul wrote and said, try to entertain visitors. And as you do that, you might entertain angels. Because some of you, it is possible angels has appeared to you, but because you are looking for feathers. Some of you, when you see the feather, you say, aha! Yesterday I saw angels, but no. In fact, they can even take my face and appear to you. That is why a lot of you see me in the dream. How many of you, yesterday you dream about me? Now, most of the way you see my face, it's not me, because me myself too, I'm dreaming. It's sometimes because I'm the one you see regularly and I preach the word. So the one doctor, they can use my face to appear. That doesn't mean it's me. Now let's go. Let's go. Abraham hastened unto the tent to Sarah and said, that is when you have a good wife. All the women, listen to me very carefully. When you marry a spiritual person and you become rebellious, you can cause a lot of problems. This one, we have finished eating. The son, the lady has finished cooking breakfast, lunch. He is resting. Abraham rushed to the place and said, and Abraham hasting. If you look at the New Living Translation, you see the way hasting came in another way. Watch this. So Abraham ran back to the tent and said to Sarah, hurry! If I to be, hey, wait, what is it? Well, hurry for what? What's the problem? Huh? Can you watch the lady by you? Can see that you do that and even do it another angle. Now watch it. Hurry. Get three large measure of your best flour. Kneel it into a dough. And don't stay to prepare the dough. Today you take it to a machine. It's not an easy thing. The way you have to. Huh? And bake some bread. Hey. Then if you're to be, you say, no, wait. Hey. Excuse me, wait. What is it? Then you say, I saw three men come, three men passing. You know what you tell your husband? I'm in a good mood, not because of the camera. I will give you some dirty slap right now. You tell them, let them pass. Where do you know them? Where are they coming from? You say, oh, they are from France, my friend. That is when you have a good wife. All these things have played. Now, do you know why I know? There are a lot of symptoms of this woman that you can tell you are very good wives. This generation has never become like that. Apart from that, their husband can even take them to France on a vacation and with all the ladies at the beach and say, tell people I'm your sister. And they will obey. You think submission is when you cook jollof rice? No. Have you seen the way you are quiet if your woman talk? No, you don't read the Bible. A lot of our daughters and their marriage is not based on the word. The word the Bible is talking about submit to your husband is hard work. In fact, let me put quote in quote, you have to live like a fool. You have to literally look like, live like you don't have sense. You literally become like a slave, and that is why you become like this one. This woman in the Bible. No, 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 let's read the Bible logically. How many of us, even if I'm a woman, I don't think I'll do this. Some strangers are passing. Then you go and call them to the house. You have never met them. You don't know them. In this generation of, you ask your husband, what about if they have coronavirus? What are you, are they wearing face masks? Where do you get them from? And I'm sure he called them at the COVID time. Think about it. And Abraham ran out on the head and chose a third. No, so, man of God, it's not only the bread, though. You're going to do goat rice soup and kebab. No, it's there. Abraham ran to the head and chose a tender calf and gave it to his servant to quickly prepare it. So apart from the bread, there will be rice soup. Now, keep going. Keep going. When the food was ready, you see, you read the Bible and you think that the thing that the Bible said ready, it happened within 2 minutes. It might take a distance of about 6 hours. You prepare the dough. You do the bread. You keep it there for you to kind of, is it rice? No, into. That's all. It's not rice. It's not into. Then you keep it there. Then you put it in the oven. Whilst the bread is going on, you are cutting the goat. And you are kind of fixing the kebab. And whilst you are grilling the kebab, you are preparing rice soup. It's not an easy thing. And it's for 3 men. So actually, when we hear the word Abraham was God's friend, God ate in his house. Come back. Come back. Change to King James. Change to King James. No, okay. Now you stay there. I'll get to a place and I'll let you. And when the food was ready, Abraham took some yogurt. At that time, and milk and the roasted meat, and he served it to the men, and all this were prepared by Sarah. I'm telling you, and I'm going to tell you more. Look at your sister by the way, say, do we look like Sarah? Per axiom. No, the men stay aside. Let the lady talk to them. Say, do we look like Sarah? We don't look like Sarah. We don't. No. We have gone to Beijing conference and we have messed our equilibrium. Outside the context of the word of God, give the Lord a clap of when I'm preaching. No. Now hear this. Look at your neighbor and say, let's go back to the Bible. Back to the Bible. Now listen. Until we get back to the Bible, we can enjoy the marriage. We will live like roommates. When you are serving, you think you are a fool. Because your friend will tell you that. Why are you sleeping? Yesterday, he brought some 3 men. And I said, hey, and you there, you are like a house help. So some of you as friends that are polluting you. Wrong friends. I mean, you know, yeah, I'm telling you the truth. Wrong association, wrong friends, wrong. No. No. I'm one of the ones I'm surprised, those who are married by you, all your friends are not married women. What kind of counsel are you getting from them? No. 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 Have you noticed that? By the grace of God. The people I call friends, they are all fathers. Me, I don't have a ministry friend like my age. Papa Isu, Papa Takia Boy. These are the, and sometimes the greatest thing, let me tell you, the greatest secret that has helped in ministry. Sometimes you can come to Portes and there is Papa Isu, Bishop Takia Boy, and we see our great men of God, number five. And when we sit in a dining hall, we are eating, the things they share there is what has kept me. Because listen, listen, those things, they are not for the pulpit. That is where they show you their scar, not their trophy. Do you hear what I say? No, because there is no general without a scar. If he has gone to war, some bullet has hit his leg. But most time, when they come to the pulpit, they show their trophies. But what you need is a scar. Now, watch this. So, I'm sitting with Bishop Jemisa, who has married close to 40 years. One day I was walking with Richard Roberts. I was driving him. We were going to eat. Richard Roberts, Ora Roberts' son. And then we were going to Holiday Inn for when he got married, I said, hey. So I asked him, I said, Richard, 44 years of marriage, wow. I said, Richard, what are them, some of the key problems in marriage? And he told me, he said, all marriage problems are two, sex and money. I said, huh? I said, explain. He said, no explanation, you will learn it. He left me there. He said, no, I can't explain it to you. All marriage problems are, I said, what do you mean by sex and money? He said, that is all the problem. When a man is angry, they go to the root of the matter. The underlying point is that he has been denied sex somewhere. Have you seen only men are shouting? Have you seen that no woman is shouting? All the men that are shouting, they are all marriage men. Pastor Fred was shouting, Mickey was shouting, and they are all marriage men. All the women were standing there. Now, there is a problem. Let me tell you something. When a woman denies a man sex, she doesn't understand. She doesn't even understand why you want sex at that time. And it takes maturity for them to understand the effect. That is why one of the greatest problems you have is when you marry and you are not growing. Mental development. Knowledge. You have studied to understand that. No. What happened? In fact, Paul said that defrauding not one another is so crucial that Paul put it in the writing. Except to be concerned with fasting. And that way, even some when you are in agreement, except two of you have agreed. Except two of you, that means that if you decide to fast, it's not agreement. You fast your fast. Let me do my work. It's not that. There's two things. There's a one that we agree. Both of us say, okay, today we agree to fast. You are there and you say you had a vision, so you are fasting. Go ahead, fast. We won't go to details about it, but we'll leave it for you to go and meditate on that scripture. Sex and money. What is the aspect of money? By nature, because of the way God created them. Eh? People think women like money. They don't. But you need money to care for them. Because, yes, they were created in a state of comfort. You notice that when they came to the garden, they didn't do anything. They only came to eat fruit. And cause problem. They were plucking fruit from left and right. The one they shouldn't pluck, they pluck it. The one they should pluck, they let me there. Look at your sister and say, fruit eaters, tell them fruit. And they are still eating the fruit. Do you know the moment we came here, we check into a hotel. Mommy went to buy apple. I said, Kado buyer. Immediately, I remember the garden of Eden. I said, these people, fruit. And up to date, you forced me to eat fruit. They said, I was eating. As if we were there when he served me. He brought fruit first. Then I remember the garden. I said, hey, this fruit matter. I wanted to eat the shrimp. He said, eat the fruit. Look at your brother and say, you continue. You will be eating fruit. Oh. The fruit matter, it has not stopped. We are still eating. I'm teaching. No. Richard Roberts says sex and money. Let me tell you something. When a woman marries you, boy, don't continue to be broke. It will not help you. I'm telling you, don't continue to be broke. And all the, if the women are not clapping, at least the men should be clapping for Jesus. Don't continue to be broke. Look at your brother and say, brother, we got to make some money. Tell the brother, we have. Going on, these breakages. Based on the conditions they find themselves in, they will adjust them to marry you. And they have a mind you make. When my wife married me, I was very broke. She was working in a bank. If it's was my salary, the amount of money he pays was the equivalent of what then the last. With your nose, see you are getting broke. Don't get broke. Tell the person you have to make some money. Make some money. Be careful. No, don't become broke. Now let's answer the question quickly and then get to what we have to get to. I don't even know where I was. Let's read about Abraham. Put the scripture there. Put it there. When the food. And as they ate, Abraham waited on them. Abraham took some yogurt. And when they waited, Abraham was standing there. They waited for them in the shade of the trees. And they ate. Now, watch. When they finished eating, the moment they finished eating, they don't recognize them. You get a blessing from the Lord. I don't know where they come from. One man, of course. Wait, don't clap. We have done that from the foundation of the ministry. First 2 years of our ministry, from that to salvation, we never did anything. Nobody was paid. Nobody cared. The only thing was paying was the place of rent. And it was not really expensive. That was the first fruit of ministry. Number one, let me show you something. And learn a lot of lessons from what I'm going to talk about. If you remember the beginning of this scripture, these men were passing. They carried the word of Abraham. They carried a prophetic word of Abraham, but they were passing. It is Abraham that discerned and called them. When, and they said unto him, where is Sarah thy wife? The man he has never met, the man that he finished cooking for, that maybe the wife was reluctant to cook for. The man said, and he said, behold, he's in the tent. Let's look at this man. And he said, no angel can talk like this. This is what I brought you. No angel. I will certainly return to thee according to the time of life. No angel can talk like this. And lo, Sarah thy wife shall have a son. And Sarah, so no angel can talk like this. I will certainly return. This is the God that met him in Genesis chapter 17 and established a covenant. And let him circle and came down and said that I am going to make your descendant. That God appeared in the form of a man. And the God is talking, say, I will set you, no angel. An angel, let me show you the way angel call. Hey, thou that are highly feared, the Lord is with thee. My name is Gabriel. I was sent from heaven. This one, look at the way he's talking. I will certainly return. Huh? And to according to the time of life, and lo, Sarah, thy wife shall have a son. And Sarah had it in a tent door, and which was behind him. Now, this is another thing. When they were talking here, Sarah was in the room there. Sarah heard it and Sarah laughed. And the man talking here saw it. He saw Sarah laughing where he cannot see her. Go ahead, go. Huh? Keep going. Verse 11. Keep going. Huh? Now, Abraham and Sarah were old, as if we don't know, and were stricken in age. And he ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of woman. Do you understand? This is why I call menopause versus papapause. It means that menstruation, ovulation is cut off. Therefore Sarah laughed within him, within herself, saying, after I am waxed old, all these things. He said it inside her. He heard it in his love and said, after I am waxed old, shall I have pleasure, my Lord being old also? So the firing has ceased. This is a major test of faith. Therefore, Sarah loved within herself after I've waxed old. Verse number 13. And then the Lord said unto Abraham, wherefore did Sarah laugh? Now come back to verse number 12 and give me the New Living Translation. I want it to come alive for them to get it. Not everybody is used to King James. So Sarah laughs silently. So you see, this one will bring it in a way you understand. To herself, and said, how could a worn out woman like me enjoy such pleasure? Worn out, especially when my master, my husband, is also old. So old. Keep going. Watch this. This is, you are dealing with a miracle working God. The Lord said to Abraham, why did Sarah laugh? Abraham could have defended and said, no, my wife is not laughing. But the God has already seen. Now listen, all the tears in your bedroom, he sees it. Wow. Yeah. Sees it. Watch this. Why did she say, can an old woman like me have a baby? So what she said in the inside, God pick it. Then the Lord said to Abraham, okay, verse number, is anything too hard for the Lord? I will return about this time next year and Sarah will have a son. This is a prophecy to Geneva. The Lord will return next year by this time and you are going to have a testimony. The reason we come for invasion, we keep coming, is that we come and the next time we come and hear what God did the last time we came. So next year we'll come and hear what God is doing with your life on the last encounter. Are you alive? Put it there and let me finish it. Hallelujah to Jesus Christ. Glory be to God in the highest. If you know the scripture, you struggle, don't take it out, leave it there. So anything too hard for the Lord, Sarah was afraid, so she denied, saying, I didn't laugh. But the Lord said, no, you did laugh. Another thing, Jesus, when women get afraid, they laugh. That one, we'll talk about it. Hallelujah. When they become afraid, they laugh. It's unconscious lie. Forgive them. Amen. Then the next verse, watch this. Then the men got up from their meal and look out towards Sodom as they left, Abraham went with them to send them on the way. So he just escorted them. Then look at the next statement to shock you. The men, the Bible keep using the word men. Then one of the men said, should I hide my plan from Abraham? The Lord asked.
Wow.
The Lord. The three men that were walking, one of them said that, I have a plan. Should I hide it from Abraham? The man. This Abraham man, he was something else. I did a study on him and I have not still exhausted a lot of things. If I want to go to a point, when the revelation opened up, I was so frightened and I stopped. Because people see angels, they became blind. Abraham saw them and walked with them. Now listen, Jesus, light, shine on Paul. Paul instantly lost his sight. Should I hide my plan from Abraham? The Lord asks. Now, wait, look at the way the King James put it. Look at the King James. Flip to King James and then you come back to New Living Time. And the Lord said, shall I hide from Abraham the thing which I do? So the man that the Bible, the one that was eating Abraham's house, in fact, in the Bible, the only recorded man God ate in his house is Abraham. Come back to the New Living Translation. The Lord. And the Bible said, men, should I hide my plan from Abraham? The Lord asked, keep going. See, he's going to be, for Abraham will certainly become a great and a mighty nation. And all the nations of the earth will be blessed through him. Wow, I have singled him out so that he will direct his sons and their families to keep the way of the Lord by doing what is right and just. Then I will do for Abraham all that I have promised. Keep going. Wow, something is falling in Geneva. So the Lord told Abraham, I have heard a great outcry from Sodom and Gomorrah because their sin is so fragrant. Ajibe be a sentinel. So fragrant. Watch this. I am going down to see if their actions are as wicked as I've heard. It means that the angels keep bringing the mistakes and the sin and the report, but now he's coming to investigate himself. There are mysteries in the Bible. If not, I want to know. This is the key. Now let's come back so that we won't go deep and dive in. We are answering the question. I think I've even answered the question of how God put the tree of evil. So you see, God come down sometimes in the Bible. And when you see God establishing a covenant, he is trying to make sure that when you make a mistake, he will bring you back. If that covenant was not established, you will be thrown to hell like the devil. Now, there is another key you have to understand. We spoke about what is the first thing in the covenant, the promise. Be fruitful, multiply, replenish. What is the next thing about it? They cut Adam and blood goes out. The first surgeon is God. I call him the master surgeon. Do you know the interesting thing about his surgery? He doesn't have a recovery wall. When he finish, you jump up and you are just watering him. That is why, up to date, he can still replace a kidney, a liver, fallopian tubes. He can do it. And this, even if you have faith, God is going to do it and do it. Hello? Is my time up? 5 minutes more. Watch this. Amen. So, blood was shed. And then the next one was what? The terms of the covenant. So the reason for putting that tree there to establish a covenant, you can eat of the greatest sin is disobedience. Now hear this. I thank God when I saw that revelation. I see who? The Adamic covenant is the only covenant that is not sealed. The seal of the covenant is to eat the tree of life. Some of you think when God drove them out of the garden, you think God was weak. If they took that fruit and ate it, they will live in sin for life. And they will not be a working plan for their salvation. So they have to be out so that I work a plan. So actually, when we go to heaven, we are going to eat that tree. It is the eating of that tree that will move us from time to eternity. And that is where you never die. So God drove them out. So you see, the moment they finish eating the food, man, they start contaminating the blood. Now hear this. Every attack you see in the Bible from the pit of hell is geared towards one thing. One thing. One prophetic word that came out of God's mouth. Satan, because of what he did, the seed of the woman. That word, that is why Satan hates women. The reason the devil hates women is because of that word. Up to date, he hates them so much. The seed of the woman. And that one confuses him. The creator can confuse the creation. You know, he said the seed of the woman, when women don't have seed, they have egg. So when he start killing her, do you know why the devil entered, came to kill Abel? He thought Abel was the seed. So Genesis chapter 1 to chapter 11, you see the first things of life, first murder, first sex, first sin, first killing, first everything. It's in there. When you read Genesis chapter 1 to 11, chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 11, you will learn a lot of things about life. The first kind of everything, first sin, first surgery, first killing, first murder, first sex, first born, first child, first labor ward, everything. It's all there. The seed of the woman. So when he moved the angels to sleep with the woman and they produce abnormal people, at that time, they did it and spread it so much that the only house that was not contaminated was Noah's house. Now, if all the people get contaminated, then the Messiah cannot be born. So let me keep this eight and kill everybody so I can raise a new seed. That is the reason why I called it. For instance, the Israelites came to Shechem and they make a covenant. Jacob and his people make a covenant with the kings of Shechem. We will give our daughters to you and we'll give you give your sons to us. It means they are going to contaminate the Messianic blood. And the covenant is serious. They establish a covenant. And they even let the people circumcise themselves. Who were uncircumcised. Because the circumcision was have to be with the direction of the Lord. So do you know, God look at the earth and say, wow, how do I preserve the seed? And he check and see the only place, at that time, the only country whose citizens are not permitted to marry a foreigner was Egypt. So he sent them there. The Israelites in Egypt for 400 days to raise them because the devil's attack was the seed of the woman. He didn't know it. Now look at it. When he kept killing after years, he thought that God is now confused. He can't bring the seed. So even when Jesus born, he couldn't recognize. Watch this. Do you know the interesting thing about Christ? God didn't need Joseph. But as long as Joseph is walking with Mary, Satan thought it's Joseph's sperm. The Bible said, if the princes of this world have known, it was hidden from them. Everything was a setup. So actually, the killing was killing. God decided that, this killing can be the trap. He keep killing. The Lord said, the thief coming not but for to steal, to kill. So he said the killing. So God said, wow. So don't ever deceive yourself that everything you say or you pray, Satan hears. No. It was an angel that spoke to Mary. How can this be since I don't know a man? The Holy Ghost shall come upon you. The power of the Highest shall overshadow you. Satan didn't hear that. If he had, he could have said, Have you seen the difference between the first Adam and the last Adam? This is the first Adam. Lie down. Clay. And then God stood and said, and the moment the breath went to the clay, Adam became a living soul. Second Adam, God looked at Mary and said, so you see, there is no difference between this and that. That is why this one is called the last Adam. God breathed into a woman's womb by the word, and conception took place. That means that this is where you don't get confused. Don't confuse Christianity with any other religion. Every other religion master was born by sperm. Every other one. I don't care what they think. Our master, that is why the one that came out, that is called Christ, is called the last Adam. There will not be any Adam again. That means that this whole thing has ended. By the same breath, the Holy Ghost shall come upon you. The power of the Highest shall overshadow you. That holy thing. So in the spirit, when the word of God was coming, then conception take place. No, Joseph, I have a plan for you. Don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife. That which is carried is of the Holy Ghost.
Don't touch her.
This whole thing is a setup. But that is another principle. You don't sleep with a woman that carry pregnancy that is not for you. Never. If you want to live long, don't try that. If a woman is pregnant and you are not the one who caused the pregnancy, if you sleep with that woman, you are in danger. Even if you don't know, it's not an excuse. You need grace and mercy. That is why Joseph never touched Mary. In fact, all his metabolisms and all the actions were suspended. She can't until after Mary delivered. Now, let's see the setup. When the devil told Jesus, she activated his weapon. I must kill this guy. That is where the trap was. You don't kill a man that has never seen. Because the wages of sin. But this one has never seen. He killed him. Bam. And when he killed him, she realized that, I've made a mistake. That is what bet me and you. Listen. If Jesus didn't die, the death is not really the miracle. It is a resurrection. Now hear this. It is a resurrection. That is what makes the difference. Do you know that? If you are in a thick darkness and somebody threw a car light, if you are not careful, you cannot be able to, you will not even be able to see anything. The worst thing that happened to hell at that time is that when hell was celebrating, they saw light coming. So Jesus actually walked to hell with light. 3 days. Revelation chapter 1 verse 18. Look at when he went to hell. Look at the picture he gave us to us when he went to hell. Wow, I love that. Jesus went to hell and came back and said, I am Alpha, verse 18, Revelation chapter 1. I am, give me King James Version. Jesus, this guy is, no. I am he that liveth. I was dead, but I am alive forevermore. I am he that liveth. I was dead. He's giving a picture of what happened when he went to hell. And behold, I am alive forevermore. And I went to hell. I now have the keys. Hear this. This is the reason why you shouldn't be afraid of death. Any other key of death Satan is threatening you with is a counterfeit one. Yeah. But hear this. What you have to learn about counterfeit is that I can also start a car. That means that if I get your car key and I take it to the key cutter and cut the same thing, the only thing is that it's illegal, but it's effective. It can still open the door. A counterfeit key can open the door. It can start a car. The only thing is that it's illegal. So when Satan threatens you with death, it's illegal. Because he doesn't have the key. He used to have the key, but Jesus took the key from him. And if Jesus have the key, then he has it to your advantage. So when you are there, the devil came and said, I'm going to kill you. Tell him, Satan, you don't have the key. Now hear this. Everybody will die. But don't die at the wrong time. Hey. Don't die. You got to die at the right time. Finish your work. Finish your assignment. Live very old. Marry. And fire up to about 120. And then depart. In fact, I love the way Dr. Mars Moro blessed him when he said, die empty. Die empty. Empty. And me, I'm determined to die very, very empty. Give out everything. Now, have you learned the reason why God put the tree in the garden? Today, we have answered the question. It was because of a covenant. If he didn't put it there, like you, we will all go to hell like the angels. The reason he sent Lucifer to hell is that he has no covenant with angels. But he has covenant with men. Now, hear this. Look at another man he established a covenant with. He established a covenant with a man. The man lied that my wife is my sister. Abimelech said he's a liar. God said he's a prophet. Now, listen. There are people you criticize. Oh, this man of God, he did this and did this. And sometimes you don't understand why God is using them. It might be a covenant. So just be careful the way you talk about people. Just be careful the way you Christian. I don't know. I hear you have done. Have you seen some men of God? There's a lot of rumors and controversies, but they are highly anointed. Oh yes. I know some of them, they sleep with people's wife. Hey. And they are still on the ministry. Oh, yeah. They are there. I'm telling you. Some too, they didn't even sleep or they hugged them. God said, you are finished. You know, it was 3 days ago, I was in a plane coming, the Lord told me, the process of adultery didn't start on the practical, it starts with the thought. That is why Jesus said, you see, people mess around, they start talking about grace, grace, grace. Even the grace, the way they preach it, is very dangerous. I was telling some young men of God just before I was coming, I don't know whether it's on you, can say, boy, the demand for grace and the bar is higher than law. The law said that you take a woman practically, take her to your hotel, when you sleep with her, you have seen. Grace said, when you just look at her. Think about it. Grace said, when you lust, you have done it. That is what the master of grace said. Jesus said, anyone who lusts after a woman has already committed fornication. So the demands and the discipline for grace is higher than law. I don't know why people are preaching it. Grace doesn't wait for the practical act. Just the thought, you are judged. And it's, that's why you are not. And today we are dealing with women whose brassiere is covered half of the breast. Should I say it? Now listen, I asked a lady, I said, why is your breast so? He said, it's a bra. And I said, why? He said, I'm not the one. I like the way he answered me. He said, I don't manufacture bra. When I went there, the one they provide is the one I bought. Is that not correct? Yes. There are breasts, yes, you wear. Half of your breast is showing. And there is no bra. He told me, he said, Papa, there are no breast manufacturing company in Ghana. All the breasts are imported. So I said, couldn't you get the one that cover everything? He said, that one, they've stopped doing it. I don't know. I don't buy bra, but that is what he told me. And I couldn't continue my message again. I left it there. I left it there. And I realized I must go and fast and pray more. That is what we are dealing with now. Yeah. Take it from me. It will start from you's part of the world. Africa, because of our culture. Very soon, people will come to church with bikini. They will walk to church wearing swimming costume. And sitting there, we see them. Oh, I heard there's a revival going on. And they will come and sit there. Oh, man of God, preach on. What are you going to do? Now, you are laughing. Some of the dress people bring to church. What is really the difference? That is why some of you guys who are committing adultery and fornication and you have a problem. You have not trained your senses.
Yes, sir.
No, you have to come out of lust. The reason, because lust can never be satisfied. No. No. If you have lustful problem, you have a serious problem.
Yes, sir.
No. Serious one. And let me tell you something. Compromise has consequence. The reason God doesn't want us to sin is that he can't cancel the consequence of our sin. He can forgive the sin, but the reward for the sin, he has no right to cancel it. So he forgave David, but the sword will not depart from your house. And your neighbor will sleep with your wife. Now look at it. God didn't say Absalom, say your neighbor. That prophetic word scan with a cursor and find a son. When God released a word, the word begin to scan like a cursor and a mouse. So when it moves around as a cursor, whoever it land on must fulfill it. So watch this. Elisha said, tomorrow by this time, when the prophetic word went, he find four lepers. So anytime I release a prophetic word on you, once the prophecy comes, it begins to find somebody to fulfill it. It will whine and whine and whine and whine and whine. That is why you have to trust God for a prophecy. The prophetic word will move around and find somebody to fulfill it. Because my word will never return to me void. It must accomplish that which I please. It must prosper in the thing. So when I prophesy and say, you are going to be a millionaire, the word will begin to scan and look for somebody. Because the word must be fulfilled. If I prophesy your husband, God will begin to look for a man. The prophecy will find. So the moment Nathan said, you did this in the secret, but your neighbor, another man is going to sleep with your wife. Nathan's released a word. The word landed on Absalom. And I knew Absalom would not live long when he was sleeping with his father's wife. Look at the connection. Another thing too that connected to that prophecy is that David reinforced the prophecy by praying. Turned the counsel of Ahithophel to foolishness. So Ahithophel counsel plus Nathan's prophecy prepare Absalom's sin. You don't just hear what I said. It was the first time Ahithophel has given a wrong counsel. The voice of Ahithophel is like the voice of God. But David has prayed counter prayer. And he said, Ahithophel's counsel must be turned to foolishness. So in answer to that prayer, he gave a foolish counsel. And the counsel to David was that Ahithophel is asleep with your father's wife. Where is that coming from? Around, among the aristocrats that were serving David, Uriah, Bathsheba was like Ahithophel's grandson, daughter. Because Ahithophel has only one child and the descendant. So when he came, Uriah, it brought pain to Ahithophel's heart. One day I will trace that thing to you. And so Ahithophel was in pain. And he was retaliating. But this is the danger. Ahithophel, everybody knows him as giving counsel to David. He know he can discern the voice of God. But Ahithophel carry only one anointing. It's a counsel and the inside. But the one you are dealing with carries seven anointings. This is the danger about David. No. So David prayed a prayer that affected Ahithophel's counsel because of the multiple grace on his life. Kingship anointing. He's the only king in Israel that was anointed three times. First one in front of his family. Second one, the people of Judah. Third one, the whole elders of Israel. So that anointing, kingship anointing three times. He carried a shepherd's anointing. To the point that David, the Messiah, must adopt his name. They call Jesus the son of David. So there's a kind of messianic anointing on his life. Do you know that David, thousands of years before Jesus died, David could predict what was going to happen at the cross? Psalm 22. He said that Ila, Ila, Lama, Sabatani. David prophesied that one before Jesus Christ was even dead. He has a poetic anointing. He wrote poems. He was a psalmist. Because some of the poem, we use it at warfare, but some of the things that he sang as a song is now a prayer. It's now warfare. What do we call it? Scriptures. So poetic anointing, psalmist anointing, kingship anointing, shepherd anointing. Wow. Warrior's anointing. He fought 43 battles and won all of them. David never lost one battle in life. When you are dealing with such a man, you have to be very careful. That is why I fear for people. You see, I was listening to one of the great men of God in Ghana, and he said something. He said, don't get yourself, and I you see, he is not even the type that preach about those things, just a very nice teacher. And he said, don't get yourself in fighting with men of God, because you might be fighting a battle beyond you. See, it's not in your interest. God save us, but some he called. Don't. You see, and sometimes the pride of your generation is that when you insult another man of God, you left to another church. You have the right to live in a church, but don't insult the man. Don't even do it in a secret.
That's right.
It's not necessary.
That's right.
There are battles you avoid, because one can say the things you are dealing with, you have not finished. Right. You don't go and tangle yourself with these things. You avoid it. Don't get in confrontation with them. Don't try to. It's not. Do you know the secret? It's not the men that are powerful. As I'm standing here, Satan knows I'm called. He knows it. She also knows the rules of engagement. If there is anybody that is a legalist, it's the devil. So when he sees you as breaking the law, he comes with a force. The man who can go to court and win a case, Satan went to court and removed a restraining order that was around you.
That's right.
Straight. He won the case. Bam! She won that case big time.
In heaven.
Right? That thing you call hedge, it's not God that told us so. He's the one who brought the name. Have you not made a hedge around him? How did he know there's a hedge? He shot his arrows, it was not going. He said, this guy. So he came out that thing is called hedge. God didn't tell us it's a hedge. Satan that told us.
Yeah.
Oh, you guys are not ready for what I'm trying to teach you. Look at your neighbor and say, there's a hedge around you. There's a hedge. Find three people and tell them there's a hedge around you. Do you believe that? Huh? He told them, he said, have you not made a hedge around him? Somebody say hedge. And he said, I ran all his substance and all that he had. This is where it is dangerous to prosper in the kingdom and stay out of God. Let me tell you something. The devil doesn't care anybody who has prospered and is not in Christ. It doesn't matter. But when you are in Christ, you prosper. As you are standing, Satan fear your prosperity than your prayer. Because when you prosper, you will advance the kingdom. Do you know we are here doing this conference? But it costs money. Big time. Tell your neighbor, it costs money. So tell them, stop giving coins. What was his response when we say you should stop giving coins? Huh? Lift up your two hands. It's my time up. How do you know? Are you the one who invited me? I have not started my message. My time is up. I was going to talk about some dangerous things about faith. Remember what I was going to preach? The testing of faith. The problem with everybody here is when your faith is tested. And let me hear this. Let me tell you this. The package of the test is determined by where you are going. So when you see the test is bigger, it shows where God is taking you. The Lord bless those who are clapping. They are the people that are ready for encounter. I don't even know where we learned that. We have to serve God without a test. This Abraham guy, God tested him. You know, let me tell you. I heard a message the man of God preached many years ago. He said, the God that talked funny. That was the title of the message. And he said, the God that came to you and said, count the stars. As if every 2 weeks you give birth. Literally. If you ask me to count the stars and say your descendants will be like this, I can even get confused. How much? That means every year should I give birth? And that God will move and give you a child after 30 years. Think about it. Think about it. Sit down and write this thing down for 2 minutes and let's close. Amen. Write it at number one. Testing is not demonic. To be tested is not a demonic activity. Some of you ask a lot of questions. What have I done? What did I do for this thing to happen? Tell your neighbor, testing is not demonic. Just write these PowerPoints down. Because testing is built in a system of faith. It's not demonic. John chapter 9. Verse 1 to 5. Testing is not demonic. You are being tested and you are going to be tested, and it's possible now you are. You see that you can't even open your mouth to say it. No. Tell your neighbor, it's possible God is testing you. Amen. John chapter 9. I still don't have a scripture here. I think you people got the TV. Why is it that people are not fixing all kinds of things? Now watch this. And Jesus passed by and saw a man which was blind from his birth. And his disciple asked him, saying, Master, who did sin? This is the religious mindset. The religious mindset that any time somebody is going through something, we find out what he did right or wrong. So a man was blind, and the disciples immediately asked Jesus, who sinned? Who did sin? Is it this man or his parents? Now, you can imagine, and the Bible says he was born blind, that he was made, that he became blind. And Jesus answered, neither has this man sinned nor his parent, but that the works of God. So the purpose of the man being born blind is that the works of God will be made what? Manifest. So your testing is also to prove that your God is powerful. Do you know that all Job's friends were saying, what did you do wrong? Did you fornicate? Did you kiss a girl? Oh no, they dealt with the guy. At a point, they connected the whole thing to even womanizing. Job chapter 30, is it 30 or 31? Job chapter 30 verse 1. If it's not 30, give me Job chapter 30 verse 1. You stay with the New Living Translation or whichever. Job chapter 30. I'm surprised about your computer. But now, 31 verse 1. It should be one of them, either 30 or 31. Because I see a dog there and there's no dog. I made a covenant. You see, when they challenge me, say, I made a covenant with my eyes. Why should I think about a maid? Are you getting it? But you give me the Message Bible and look at the way the Message Bible put it. Eh? The Message Bible, Job came and said that. So when the people were dealing with Job, they even came to the place and they were trying to let the guy know, I made a solemn pact with myself never to undress a girl with my eyes. So you see, Job said that Job was so pure that he covenanted with his eye. Because there are men who are undressing women, according to the scripture. You can use your eye to remove a stretch jeans zip. You are hypocrite. Let me try the people here. No, it is there. I made a solemn pact with myself never to what? Undress a girl with what? Not my hand. Hear this. The major problem of a man, if you don't circumcise this, you are in trouble. This thing, it might be circumcised. That is why you are watching pornography. Your eye is not circumcised.
Preach it.
The eyes. It can even affect a major prophet. Samuel went to Jesse's house and I can hear goes, hey, Samuel! She was almost pouring oil on the wrong person. God said, hey, he almost anointed the wrong man for God. And that day, God came to the statement and said, man, look at the outward. The guy you are anointing, his heart is not correct. But in the eyes of man, he looks like a king. That is why a lot of men keep choosing wrong women as wife. Because the package. I don't know why you are quiet, but if you're a wrong wife, you know I'm not the one saying it. You should have that's it. Amen. It's never too late to be right. We have a problem. Amen. The shape can deceive you. In fact, you know it after 20 years of marriage. People didn't marry for where they were going, they marry for where they were. And they find out that who. As you are enjoying and to God be the glory, and then you are waving. When the devil has set you up, he said, oh, they keep waving. Continue. Straight. You see, when you have to fight, don't use women as shame. Let me tell you the greatest sin of Solomon. The land is not supposed to be taken by agreement and treaties. It has to be a fight. This is what Solomon did. He will go and marry the daughter of the king of Egypt. And once I marry your daughter, you can't fight me. You see, the wisdom, when it gets perverted, they go to Amalekite and pick his wife. So Solomon used his ways to secure the land. It's in the Bible. Instead of fighting. But his father engaged the sword. And up to date, it's David alone that conquered the whole land. He fought 43 battles. Won every one of them. Solo was using waste. So you see, some of the kings, he will marry three of their daughters, 900. So the kings couldn't fight him because of their daughters. That is the power of a woman. They can even stabilize war. Because of women, you never heard Solomon fighting a battle. Never. The battles were in the bedroom. Solomon will carry this one's wife. He married the Egyptian king's wife, the Amalekite, the Philistine. Every king, he picked a wife from them. And he was a wise guy. He was the center of attraction. Solomon was like a tourist attraction. The queen of Sheba came and said, half of the story has not been told. What is this? Even the queen of Sheba, he developed a romantic relationship. You see, that woman was so powerful that there was no man in this country that can be his equalizer. So when he met Solomon, he said, this is the kind I'm looking for. And so go and read the songs of Solomon. It's about Solomon and the queen of Sheba. That is why I taught this like my sister, my spouse. It started like a sister relationship and it get into something. He said, you are dark and beautiful because the king of Sheba, the queen of Sheba was from Africa. Amen. Tell your neighbor, you'll be tested. You'll be tested. This is a major point. Why do God test us? Why should my faith be tested? I'm glad you asked. Because God can never trust anybody he has not tested. That is why when Abraham lifted the cutlass to kill Isaac, he said, now I know. But you don't know me. Do you know something? There is something you have that God can't touch. It's called your way. It is that thing that make you kneel down and worship. It's that thing that make you give sacrificially. It's that thing that make you accept. You see, because of the will, that is why God doesn't want any man to rape a woman. Because you break his will. Rape is one of the highest forms of sin. In the rape, if you don't take care, you come under a curse. The consequence of rape is shameful death. Even if the Lord don't take you, the supernatural will come after you. Yeah. Look at a man and say, never rape a woman. Tell the person. No. Even your wife. That is why the Bible says, defraud ye not another. If you touch her, you say, quick, sleep. Just speak in tongues or go and shower hot water and sleep. You can't force her. No, you can't. Because if God doesn't touch our will, you can't touch anybody's will. No. We are not created as robots. This is not remote control. They're like when Eve was going to eat the fruit, God could have pressed stop. Covenant, willingly. So you receive Jesus willingly. If I'm chasing you, you can say no, but I have to chase you until you say yes. When you say yes, willingly. One lady came to me and said, Daddy, I'm pregnant. He slept with me. I said, wait, did he rape you? He said, I said, answer the question. Did he rape you? He said, Daddy, I will explain. I said, explanation. Okay. Where did you have your first sex? He said, this hotel. I said, okay. Did he carry you there? No. You walk there. You know, some of you that want to see me, when you sit in front of me, you regret that you came to see me. I say, you walk there, or you fly, or you were, what did you do? He said, Daddy, I walk. And I said, really? I said, what dress were you wearing? I said, I was wearing skirt and suit. Who removed the suit? He said, myself. A spirit of slapping came upon me at that time. One day, You commit adultery willingly. You fornicate willingly.
Yes, sir.
That is why when you finish sinning, the only thing you must cry is mercy. Because you did it willingly. Totally. No. There is another authority. There is another thing. Let me tell you. Those of you get around pastors and you become so close to your pastor, even though you are married woman. I sat down with the Bible and asked the Lord, why didn't Bathsheba resist David? And the Lord says, it's difficult to resist people with spiritual authority. So there is a line you cross. You even forgotten you were married woman because of the authority. That is why I say, what make people escape adultery is not prayer, it's boundaries. The authority the man carries. No. But Sheba didn't even shake her body. Didn't say anything. Willingly, because I mean, can you be toso? Say that in French. Interpret it. Bibi toso. Auntie Frida, how do we say it in French? Huh? Something will fall on you. Bibi toso. How do we say it in French?
Quelque chose est tombé sur toi.
Quelque chose est tombé sur toi. Right. Write it down. Something will fall on you. You see something has fallen on you now. Keshul atome satola. That's what it is. That is why people can have an affair with their boss. That is why a student can have an affair with his professor and get a pass mark. Because when you cross a certain line, no, spiritual authority. No. So even pastors, be careful the way you get people close. The magnetic force around a woman, it has nothing to do with whether you are anointed or not.
Yes, sir.
When you cross a certain line, all your defenses get broken.
That's right. That's right.
Because a woman is a very mysterious, powerful creature. Very powerful. Let me tell you something. When I step down steady, they don't even know the power they carry. Yes. One day I asked a woman, I asked God, I said, Lord, why are we so vulnerable before this woman? I read the Bible. One day David said, why are the mighty falling? Including himself. Mighty men of God, they were reduced to a morsel of bread by women. Hey. Huh. I have seen men of God there. I have seen powerful politicians. Young girls tell them, take a picture, lift your leg, crap. Do like this, crap. Do like this. And they were powerful men. Young girls, they say, do like this. They do it. Crap. They took a picture. Am I online? And you are making me do all these things. Geneva people. So you can be a pastor. A woman will tell you. Huh? A man of God told me, say, I slept with a girl in my church. And I came to church and I'm preaching. Without holiness, no one. Said, the girl said, the girl will say, sit at the corner. Say, the man said, and Abraham was a very wet. He changed his message. By the blink of a woman's eyes, you can't preach what God wants you to preach. May you be delivered from bondage. May you be delivered from affliction. That, now, let me tell you something. Let me tell you the message. Sit down and listen to this. Do you know why God doesn't want you? A woman's mindset with sex. When you sleep with a woman in the spirit realm, every force around him, once you sleep with a woman, in his mind, he owns you.
Nice.
Period. Whether they know it or not, that is very spiritual.
Yeah.
That is why little girls can dribble old men.
Yeah.
Because once you enter a woman, in his mind and in the realms of hierarchies, he owns you. So he can even keep you in his bedroom while your wife is at home and say, you are not going anywhere.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Ask those who have done it before. Ask them. Yeah. Ask them. Say, sister, do you remember? Don't ask them. Ask them, do you remember? The guy you can. Yeah. They can keep you in their room.
Yes,
so you don't try that. No. A man can sleep with you once and doesn't want to see you again. But the woman is not like that. Number two, let me tell all the women here. Men don't have sex because they love you. Let me talk to you as a father and as a man. We don't have sex because of love. We have sex because we have a lot of spermatosia, which is looking for a place to download it. Every man here has billions of spermatosia. That's the way God created. We just want to offload it. So men don't have sex. So that thing, I love you, is just lust. You remember the guy that slept with you once and never call you again, block you? I'm very sorry to remember your pain, but let's go to his phone and pull his message and read some of the messages. I'm very sorry to remind you, but that is, I just want you to know, you should have learned a lesson from it. Because you thought he loves you. Now, let me tell you something. This is the reason God wants us to marry in virginity. If I'm chasing you and I've never seen your nakedness, I can walk from here to France. In the cold weather. Because of you, I don't care. Pneumonia, I don't care. I'll be walking with that jacket. I'm coming. So a man will pay every price for a woman he has not seen his nakedness. So this is a key. Don't give your body to them when they've not taken you to the altar. Don't do it. Siri, don't do it. Don't. You reduce your value from 1,000 francs to 1. And unfortunately, let me tell you, unfortunately, if you are not lucky, you meet the type that has tested Rebecca, tested Hannah, tested Suzy, tested Shukwanda, and Sister Shenene, and Sister Bosca, and you are the seventh. When we come to protest, we counsel people. Finally, those who come to me, I ask them very strong questions. I don't joke. I'm trying to diagnose the problems of the divorce in our generation. Because those stupid manual counseling we are playing games with people, we are not dealing with the practicality. There was a recent marriage. They came to me and then I said, okay. I asked the girl, go out. I asked the guy, I said, wait for me at the reception. I said, the girl, I said, hey, are you a virgin? He said, no, daddy. It's okay. How many men have you slept with? I said, about five. Okay, who broke your virginity? At what age? After that, it's okay. I said, okay, you wait for me. I called the guy. Have you slept with a woman before? He said, no, I'm a virgin. Have you seen the two people that are going to one? Now, this one, the manuals don't give the counseling. So the girl is in another level. The guy is green one. This is why I call ninja versus kung fu. It's totally different. Now, these things, the pastors don't deal with it practically. You have to begin to conscientize the woman. You have to, psychology is a study of the mind. And all problem is the mind. All problem is the mind. When you see a man say, I am impotent, the problem is not the manhood, it's the mind. Something must be deleted from the mind, and something must, oh Jesus, are you sure? It's the mind. As a man, I know soundness of mind affects every aspect of your life. When a man is under stress, extremely under pressure, certain things will not function because the mind takes it before it gives it to every part of the body. Anyway, I didn't know that the Swiss people, you are so hypocrites. You don't like practical message. Now watch this. So I sat them down and I knew immediately. Now this thing, if you don't address it, certain things are going to happen. This girl is a ninja. Is a ninja. In fact, I asked her a question. I said, your last relationship, I even asked the height of the guys. Among the guys who went out to, which one was the tallest? And he showed me, he said, one was like Pastor Joe, tall. I said, wow. I said, yeah. And this boy is going to marry, is very short. Now, this thing, if you don't deal with it, they go to the bedroom. Don't forget what Richard Robert told me. All marriage problems are sex and money. That means that we have to mature this lady mentally. And we have to bring the girl. So I finally I told her, I said, listen, the guy you are going to marry is a greenhorn. You have black belt in martial arts. This guy is not. Let me close. I have to close. I don't think you are ready for what I'm saying. No, I'm telling the pastors that are here, don't bring some manual that D.L. Moody was using or manual that A.A. Allen was using and come and teach them. Sometimes you just go to online and you download something. Check the problems practically. What they are dealing with now. Your children that are 18, they know things you don't know. Yes. I'm telling you. The merit and the demerit of the social media and the stuff like that. We don't deal with these things. We don't. What about one day we were doing marriage conference and for singles, and there was a question, and I realized that the test of it, there was one guy, he forced his wife to watch pornography before they have an affair. And I realized that where the guy is coming from. Don't underrate it. Don't take it for granted. No. We try to solve marriage problems by counseling. Go to the root of the matter. Where did it start? If you see a couple that don't trust each other, everybody's complaining, I don't trust you. This one sits in a car, this one sits in a motor, chasing the other one. Your husband just took a car, then he took, if he Ghana, Okada, they say, Okada, follow. The green car, follow. Okada, take your time, don't go close, follow. Then you are there. Do you know why you are going to die? It's trust. Trust. You kill yourself because of lack of trust. And I'm very sorry to mess your feeling. Most of trust that is broken, it broke from sex before marriage. Now hear this. If both of you are not born again and you came here and became born again, that's a different. But when you sit in a church, born again, tongue talking, you start having sex. So some of the couple, they come and say, one day some of them were sitting and say, have you had sex? They bad. I say, lift up your head and talk to me. I'm asking you a question. I say, if you come and I'm doing like this, you understand what I'm saying? Will you understand it? I say, okay, sit down. Interpret it. I say, never use your head. I say, have you had sex? You say, yes, daddy. How many times? You couldn't even count. I say, wait. Stop the wedding. Postpone it. Stay for 6 months without sex. If you're able to do that, come back. We'll get you married. Simple. Pray together. I say, the reason I'm doing this is that I want you to come to the place and kill, because forgiveness is a decision, but trust is a process. Yes. And when you lose trust, you lose the confidence of the marriage. That is where you are always searching. You take his phone and you want to find out, because lack of trust will let you go into things you are not supposed to go into. And if you're a married man and you lose the trust, work hard to bring it back. Don't force. You have to trust me. What is that? No. Two things. Work it hard. Come back home early. If possible, don't put a password on your phone. Leave it, honey. This is my phone. Do everything to work the trust to come back. No. You already have broken trust, and then you come home late. And then when you have a call, you go and listen to her at the toilet. You are not working on the trust. And then you are forced, you have to trust me. No. It doesn't work that way. And don't deceive yourself to think that when you break your marriage, there is no guarantee the next one will work. Statistics shows that all those that divorce, 50% of them, their next marriages don't work. The reason is because the same demons run away, you face them. All women are the same. At a point, you frustrate yourself. So stay with this one and work on it. No? So when you are courting, they put you by the wall, they are saying to kiss you, tell him, say, boy, take your time. Touch your body and say, I know you have heated, but take your time. And tell him that this thing will affect us. I love you, you love me, but to affect us. Let's work the process and get married. If we do this, we are, and let the guy know, if I give my body to you, I might not even marry him. Some of you here can testify some relationship that you went along 3 years and it got broken. Why? No. Look at the study. They put a hen and a cock. The cock crossed the hen. And the next thing was when he see food, then he gave it to the hen. He didn't mind the hen for about 2 hours, 1 hour. Then they brought a new hen. He jumped on it and crossed it. They brought another new hen. He brought on it. So they find out that men love varieties. It's inside them. That is why without the Bible, you cannot suppress that thing. It's Adamic nature. No, these Swiss people, I don't think they can handle me from tomorrow. Are you sure you can handle this from tomorrow? Yes. Hallelujah to Jesus. Work on it. So it's not your interest, your husband touch you and I'm tired. You are pushing the car. Hey, be careful. This is a generation that you don't wait for the man. You have to chase him. You steady him, steady his strength. After 1 week, come and say, hey boy, you are not eating. Why have you been eating? Please. This is your buffet. Eat. No, these are knowledge. The Christians are clapping for Jesus. Now I'm closing with this. Finally, the next statistic they show us that they say the love, the compassion, and the attention for caution. If we take even 50% to marriage, no marriage will break. When men are chasing girls, the attention, the sacrifice. How many men remember what I'm talking about? You know the water I fetch? Hey. 12 midnight, this guy is going to distribute water. Where mommy was living, there was no water. The pipe was not flowing. Where I was, pipe 24 hours. My car there, now open. Oh, Jesus. It was a water tanker. I realize that sometimes, can you pick a bottle of water from the fridge? I said, oh, it's that short here. Pick it. But I was fetching water and driving 3 hours, 2 hours. There is another key too you have to learn in marriage. When you see somebody is taking you for granted, it means that you have been there for the person.
Yes, sir.
Encourage yourself. Pastor Joe, catch what I said. The rest of you didn't catch it. So don't take it negatively. The taking for granted is a sign that you have been very faithful.
Wow.
Because people only take you for granted when you have been there for them.
When you are always there.
You are always there for them. But if you are not careful, so don't try to expect a reward for being always there. Sometimes the reward, you might not like it. That is why this stupid culture in Africa, if I've taken care for you, for your teeth to grow, take care of you for my teeth. Why do you want to lose your teeth? What? Do you know it's not biblical? No. Do you know that it's not biblical for you to raise your children for them to come and take care of you? No, you rather leave inheritance for your grandchildren. So go by the Bible side and let God bless you. My sons and daughters are coming to take care of me for what? I have studied the Bible too much for that to happen. No. I don't need anything. In fact, one day, Nana Kwame did something that shocked me. She came from school and she wanted a shirt. That time, he has not put on weight like the way America has helped him to be the way he is. And then he came and then that time, we were also wearing the same thing. So I heard the man say, go to daddy's wardrobe and pick a shirt. She came to my wardrobe and by the grace of God, people give me things. He's coming. I say, he was coming and say, Nana, did you say, no, I don't like all the shirt. Wow. Then I begin to think about a lot of things. I said, why? All my shirts there, he said, no, that they are not like it. I have one, be our wear it. Then I saw that his generation don't wear the kind of shirt I wear. His type, his generation, and his mission. No, and he added something, he said, your shirt is for old men. I kept it for myself. Don't go and fight old properties for them to kill you. Oh. My father passed away. My brother, he has some house being covered. I've not even been there. For what? I don't need anything. No. By the time you are dying, that car you have, to your son, it will be antique. You are chasing properties and they will kill you for fun, for not. You are going to confront witches and wizards. They are going to send your name to wicked altars because you have not built your life on the word. A good man leaves inheritance for his children. And I can tell you that by authority. There are people who live where you live around. Whites. They are not Christians, but they do that.
Yes.
Some of them, they will properties to their grandchildren. They do it. That's why I say they understand the principles of Christ. Yes. They don't like the person of Christ, but they go by the principle.
Yes.
We have taken the person and reject the principle.
Oh.
I'm teaching.
Yes.
Faith must be tested. Number two, so let me conclude with this. When you see people go through things, be careful the way you gossip about it. Oh, this man of God used to do this and now you can't do it again. It may be a test. Unfortunately, the gossip in the kingdom is done by the kingdom citizens. It's not the worldly people. Pastors talk about pastors. People talk about things. Something. Where did he even learn that when God... You see, sometimes people do things and I get afraid. Somebody called me and was talking about a program in London. Wow, prophet, it was massive. It was that. It was, that's what they were talking. So I told him, as a man of God, how do you measure the success of a program? On what thermometer? What instrument do you use to measure? Do you think a program is successful because crowd attended? I said, no, don't let us get this thing wrong. I said, we are getting this thing, whole thing wrong. No. The program was successful because you came. And you are the one God wants you to be there. And whoever came and whoever didn't come. No. It was successful because God made a way for us to be here. And before the... No, do you know something? Now, Auntie Frida,
yeah. It
is possible somebody travel from America or Ghana to come here.
Yeah.
And God has to bring the person here to escape death.
Yeah.
Different things are in the spirit working. Sometimes God doesn't destroy the works of the trials of the enemy. He delivers the righteous. So to, between me and you, maybe this place is a hiding place. Look at it. Take the baby and his mother and run to Egypt. So when you see Joseph going to Egypt, they say, the man, look at him. He can't get any job and he's running to Egypt. He's escaping death.
Yes.
Now, this is a mystery you must understand. If God didn't kill the people that want to kill his only begotten son, then it's not every time God kill your enemies. He just made sure you escape their trap. So every time, Lord, kill them. No, God, man, it's not time. He said the iniquities of the Amaraka is not full.
Hey.
Listen, there was a girl, was it Fafa? One of the girls, she was a nursing sister. You remember that flood that came to Ghana?
Yes,
some petrol station was, and it killed so many people. That girl, we were having a fasting program in Portis. And she's supposed to go to work that day. And he came. And I remember I told her, don't go anywhere.
Oh, wow.
I said, God brought you here to hide you. He was meeting his friend as the friend died. And he will be part of the death. So we might think we came here for program. But the steps of the good man is ordered by the Lord. Give the Lord a clap of it. The steps of the good man. So, oh my. God knows what we don't know. God see what we don't see. God perceive what we don't perceive. Hey! Because they must not find you at where you are living at this time. And it will confuse them. Take your counsel and it will not stand. Because the one you are looking for, you can't find them. And so in God's orchestration, you will speak to a servant, organize a program. Let there be a camp meeting in Switzerland. And then you bring this one from London, this one from Swiss, this one from Zurich, this one from Amsterdam, just to escape. Your ways are not my ways. Your thoughts are not my thought. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my thoughts higher than you. So listen to me. When the thing drops in your heart that you have to go somewhere, go. Go. Go there. Hallelujah. My daughter was supposed to go back to school. I wake up in the morning in London. And I told his mother, I call prof. I say, prof, Can this girl stay? And he said, let me look at. Did he say timetable? He mentioned something. Schedule. Thank you. And he went, he said, no. Some of them, no absentee. He came back. And he said, so finally his mother said, let her go back. She's supposed to go back. But I was trying to change for her to stay. So I even told her, I said, you remember last 2 weeks you had cold? And the law is that when you have cold, you can't come to lectures. So, can I pray for cold on you? And I said, no. Sometimes my wife will tell me, say, listen, me, I don't like, because you can say something and it come to pass. Yes. My wife doesn't even want me to say, because he has seen me say something jokingly, and bam, the thing happened. So, he hates me talking, even joking. He doesn't want that. He has seen that thing over the years. He says, sometimes you can just say something jokingly, and bam, the thing manifests. And the Lord came to me and told me that where I am with you, we don't accept joking. Once it comes, it's life. So I don't. There are some things it doesn't. I just don't want it to come out of my mouth. The more God grace you, the more you have to be responsible. It's dangerous to carry a certain anointing when you are not responsible. No. So finally, I was there. Sunday, I was preaching. Then I saw him giving a sign, because the following Monday he has to go. So he was sitting there, I said, Daddy. So he came. Some of you saw me. I went to talk to her. I said, what's going on? He said, Daddy, you've canceled my flight. He said, there's a wind. There's a strong wind. And even the next day, it's not possible. So they say, choose another day you want to fly, and it will cost you nothing. I told her, I said, girl, I was sensing it, but I didn't know how. This is why I was trying to call. So when I called prof said, oh, I will talk to his professors and they will send a homework and everything. Then I said, no. God has helped this guy to escape something.
Yeah.
A Nigerian man was giving me a testimony when he was doing PhD in London. And he said, they told him, everybody who come as a foreign student, this vacation, go home. At least go and see your family. He said he dreamt in a dream. He saw that she got to the airport and the flight he was coming to, the flight has taken off. So he came and said, how can the flight? He said, I'm supposed to sit in the flight. So the next day he wake up and he said, when they were going, she got to the airport, something happened. The woman checking her in did a mistake and they said, well, the gate is closed. Even if you check you in, you can't go. He said, please, my bag is even in the flight. And he said, don't worry, the bag, we can return it. He couldn't go. He remembered the dream when he went, the train was taken off. They said there were 6 students in a class doing PhD. So the other 5 went to Lagos. The next day he couldn't get a flight. And they said, well, there's no need for you to go again. When they got to Lagos, the day before they came, there were coup d'etat. And the Lagos airport was shut down. They will open. I've forgotten whether one of those schools, they said they will open. Then the other people has to defer the course. In fact, there was no opportunity for them to come back for a whole year. He's the only one who completed. But he said, I was feeling the pain. He was saying the testimony. He said, why I couldn't go? I needed to see my family. Sometimes. That is why you have to be careful. The way you have become spiritual economists. That sometimes you have to fly from maybe landing, say, plane ticket in and out, 600. You are selling your destiny with that amount of money. Listen, God gave you money so that you will use it to against the weapons of the enemy. Listen, don't economize it and then get yourself into trouble. I don't know. Some people came here, God is going to bless them. God is going to release a word on their life. But it's possible it's not only the blessing. You escape something. Number 2, some of them, the devil has disturbed you in your territory too much. So God said, take the battle to a neutral ground and shut the mouth of lions and scorpions. And by the time you go, do you know what God said that? He said, go back, because all those looking for the child's life, they are dead. By the time you go back, may the Lord kill all your enemies before you go. Because there are some prosperity here. A lady sent me an email today and he said, Papa, when I return from the camp meeting in Britain, something has happened. Let me say it, if I can get it exactly the way he sent the testimony to me. Just this morning. He said, hey, and the A is E-I-I-I plenty. Papa, you won't believe this. God is so good. After the camp meeting, the cantankerous workers in my office has changed. My boss, who doesn't like me, has become so nice to me suddenly. He said, Papa, life is indeed spiritual. Tears are even running. There is so much peace now. The people who gather to talk about me, everybody, how are you doing? You are fine. They're hugging me. And as he said, as if I'm watching a movie. Encounter. When he shifted to a neutral ground, God confused their language. Stand to your feet. Let's pray this prayer. Lord, I don't know why you brought me here. You know what I don't know. You see what I don't see. But before this come end, give me a sign. Lift up your voice and pray that prayer. Give me a sign that you have changed my story. Give me a testimony. Silence the voice of my enemies. No satri baya to sisis. Osada baya tosaya. give me a testimony, Lord. Lift your 2 hands and pray that prayer for 2 minutes, Jesus. I don't know why you brought me here, but Lord, give me a sign. Let me have an encounter. I refuse to go back the same. Geneva, lift your 2 hands and pray. Rosadiba yato se. Give me a sign. The captain of my destiny. In you alone, I make my bones. You reign on high. Oh, the champion of the hosts above, the captain of my destiny. Lift your 2 hands. The captain of my death. Lift your 2 hands and worship Geneva. Parabaya. Amen. Let me pray for that lady with the prayer shawl and his waist. Let me pray for her. She just fell under it. I just feel the prophetic anointing. In you alone, I make my boast. You reign alone, Jesus. The captain of the host above, the captain of my destiny. Oh Jesus, Marco da Basata. It has nothing to do with you. It has to do with your destiny. The trials and the tests. There is a battle in front of her. There is a battle on his left. There's a battle on his right. There's a battle at his back. And it's locked up in the center. But the Lord said, you will prevail. How do I know you have faith? How do I know you have faith? Unless you are tested. How do I know you have faith? Unless you are tested. Anybody going through tests, receive grace. I say, receive grace. Jesus. That means that. Oh, Jesus. My time is up, so watch this. That means that the testing of your faith is God's prerequisite for trusting you.
Oh, wow.
That's what it is. If you are not tested, you cannot be trusted. The problem is not let the Lord take the test away. Give me grace to go through it. You will win.
Amen.
Oh, what is this? Lift it for me. That, is it going to happen or it has happened? You see, I just laid hands on her. And I saw like he was wearing a ring and somebody pulled a ring. As if the ring. You know, normally, when you see these things, I saw the ring. It's just that a hand just pulled the ring. A hand just pulled. Have you married? Are you married? Where's your ring? Huh? Where is he? Where's your husband? He's in Ghana. Is everything okay? No. Father, fight for her.
Yes.
Now listen, I have to close the service because I don't want to get to a place if, where I'm going. We can stay here till the evening people come by. Watch this. I don't know. She's a very gifted person. She has a ministry, and she never thought things would go the way it's going. How does bad things happen to good people? But listen, open your hands. I put a sword in your hand. And even when you are asleep, this sword will fight. I don't want to go to details of the prophecy. It's quite sensitive. That means that you can marry. That is what I tell you. And they can come and pull your ring. She will prevail.
Amen.
She will win. Whichever side you go, it is working together for her good. You may be weeping today, but tomorrow you'll start laughing. No! Nothing will truncate your destiny and turn it around. Lift your hand and shout, thank you, Jesus. Marco Shadabaya. Lima Sunimi Atusaya. The champion of why he fell down over there.
And I told him that I had a dream.
You told him?
I had a dream last night.
He told you this morning. You see God? He had a dream that I've called her in the service this morning. And I was ministering to her and he told Pastor Mike. Because when I called her, the way he fell down, he said, I remember the dream. This is how you know that God is in this place. I've never spoken to anybody. He said he had exactly what is happening. She saw it in a dream. Sometimes I can literally hear God point to somebody and say, call her and pray for her. One day I was ministering in Port City and some people from Cote d'Ivoire, they came there. One of them was standing presidential election and they led her. But they sat at the back and they joined their hands. And they started praying that, Lord, if this is a true prophet, let him call us. Because we don't know him. But somebody, if it's the truth. Before they say amen, I say, what are the people from Cote d'Ivoire? I mentioned the first person. They almost collapsed. They came, they were crying, they were weeping, they were that. Girl, I don't know where he's going. I don't want to talk about the details of what I'm seeing. Whichever side it goes, it is working together for you. Amen. Because you see, you don't control somebody's love for you.
No.
My counselor who was counseling me in marriage, bring those two children. These are children from the prophetic word of by the grace of God. Huh? I prophesy. Where did you get a prophecy? Is it London or here? In Ghana. Wow. So they came for camp meeting. They were trusting God for the fruit of the womb. They said, we are going back. And I said, go and have your twins. And that is it. Wow. Which one was named after me? This one. The whole of yesterday, prophet. She will be a prophet. Amen. You see how it works? A man who was trying to win primaries for member of parliament, he has tried for years. So one of my sons brought him to me. When he came, that is what I told you, don't come here with a name and spirit. When he came, I said, go and take the seat. Go. I've given the seat to you. Then he told the guy, is that all? I thought he was coming to anoint me and pray. Pour oil and, if possible, use ajungu plus gas oil and zomi. Now, he went back. Oh boy, prophet is here. Why are you crying? Look at me, boy. I'm here. Look. Oh, come to me. Oh. want to go to? That is his Bible.
His microphone.
Your microphone. Wow. Hold your microphone. Listen. You will be holding this microphone until you are 100 years old. I'm telling you, they have started their ministry. Father, give me oil. I bless this family. So, if you are looking for the fruit of the womb, I want you to do something for somebody. Wait. Jesus. Oh, don't cry, boy. Don't cry. Father, bless the family. Honor them. From today, everything that comes to you must be double portion. In Jesus' name, amen. Watch this. This is the word of the Lord. Go for your twins. The prayer show. Come. Yeah, I want you to pray. Do you have a child?
No.
How many years have
you? It will be 7 in July.
7 years. You pray today.
I've always been praying that anytime.
He prayed that I will use him as a contact for somebody looking for children. Put your hand on his belly. Same way God gave them twins, God has given you twins. Take it. 7 years of marriage. Put your hands together for Jesus. I don't know where he's coming from. It has happened. He said the same way he prayed, that Lord, the same way. May the Lord use me as a contact. That is it. Madam, go and have your twins. By your own. It's not one boy, one girl. It's two girls. Take it. Give the Lord a shout of praise. Geneva, let's go and come this evening. Listen, I don't want you to come here alone this evening. God bless you. God richly, richly, richly bless you. Amen. Come to Portersville. Before the year end, you have to come there. There's so much prayer in the place that miracles just happen. I'm looking for the lady from Italy who has a skin disease. 18 years or thereabout. If you are watching me, leave Italy and come. He went to hospital. The doctor said it's an African disease. May the Lord forgive that doctor. Ask your neighbor, are you a doctor? When he say yes, may the Lord forgive you. Now watch this. So, did they come to Porters or somebody came and fed the water? Which one? So I don't know, a relationship or something came and fetch water from the fountain. It's called illumination. And send it. That is why we stop putting water in the fountains. People bring trucks after that testimony was shared. Also, we will put water in the fountain, but the next day the water is finished. One day I was praying midnight, I saw somebody came there with care truck, with gallons. So the lady took the water from the fountain to Italy. He bathed, the next day all the rashes left his body. This night, you will get a miracle before you leave. 6 o'clock, we are taking off in prayer. Amen. Because tomorrow morning, we have another session. This evening, I'm going to preach about your point of contact for breakthrough. Because I want to minister to people. This evening, there will be more ministration than preaching. Yesterday, I wanted to pray for some 2 white people here. God gave me a word before I know they have left. When they were going, the Lord gave me a word and said, impatient. Cast not your confidence away. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 35. Don't forget this scripture. Yesterday, I spoke to you about confidence, which is a major ingredient of faith. And the Bible says, cast not therefore your confidence Which has a great recompense of reward. Hallelujah to Jesus Christ. Cast not away therefore your confidence, which has a great what?
Recompense.
Look at the next verse. Look at what you need to get it on. For you have need of what?
Patience.
Say that very loud.
Patience.
Tell your neighbor you need patience.
You need patience.
Now let me tell this wonderful Swiss people. Even if you come from Ghana today, you are Swiss. Once you are here. Now hear this. God will never make time for people who will never make time for him. Never. If revival dies in this generation because we have time, God. When we come to Porter City, there are meetings we take time off. Sometimes we close all night, 8 in the morning. Sometimes 7. It's not because somebody, the Holy Ghost has taken. It is dangerous to cut the Holy Ghost premature. Let him finish his work.
Thank you, Papa.
And I have to be, that is what I like about Americans. The last time we were in, were we in Virginia, one of the places we were, I was supposed to do a half night. We started at 6 and we closed 4 a.m. I stood on my feet 8.5 hours unaware. Yesterday I told them something, I have to tell you. I told Pastor Nat in my room, I said, this is the only meeting I have done. I am not tired. When I asked God why, he said, the expectation is too low. Mm. So I told him, I said, the London people, they drain me. So if there is a problem here, your expectation is very low. No, I finished preaching in London. I can't even eat. I lied down and I slept. Yesterday after meeting, I did all night, half night. I told them, I said, I finished a meeting and I feel like I'm not going to preach. When you go to a place and they drain you, you can feel it. As America, you will feel it in your bones. So, the people in Europe, you have to lift your expectation. I'm telling you, London, this auditorium that packed with overflows, people were still driving around, trusting God to get a breakthrough. And that's about, he told me, he said, woman, he said, madam, there's no seat. He said, if I die, you answer. He said, hey, go. I don't want to answer anything. No, it's expectation. I said, I told them, I've never said this thing. I told Not my second. I said, I'm not tired. When people don't have expectation, it means that they are not depending on God. You check Jesus Christ. Nazareth people were asking, is that not the carpenter? Other places they were touching his garment. And, yeah. Do you know the expectation of the woman with the issue of blood? Jesus has anointed without measure. And Jesus said, virtue has left me. Do you know the quantum of anointing the woman took from Jesus? Virtue has left me. He didn't say that statement again for the rest of his life. One woman. Because expectation will forever be the breeding ground for manifestation. Hallelujah.
Amen.
If you don't have expectation, no. You see, I'm not too sure. I told mommy something, but he didn't listen. London, they were needing of prayer shows. And mommy was so passionate about. This one is a Chinese one. Yes, but Israel, you can still get a Chinese one. I want the ones have autograph.
Thank you.
Give me one.
It's autograph.
It's autograph.
Yes, sir. It's one here.
You see, the rabbis gave me the opportunity to autograph the prayer show. It's written, walk in favor. You see, in America, somebody, I think there's an examination they write to become a medical That's doctor. Right. Somebody has written the exams about 5 times and failed. So they came for the camp meeting and then they wanted me to pray. And I finished preaching after ministering to people. I was tired. So the friend said, you know what? By prayer, sure. That is the only way. Let's go so that he signs. So I finished. I said, I'm tired. I met them and the Lord said, sign it for him. So I took the prayer. I said, bring me the chair. Let me sign it for him. My son was telling me, Daddy, you are tired. I said, no, let me sign it. So when I hear, they have no head, so I have two. So I sat down and I wrote in a prayer, sure, you cannot fail. Because sometimes I don't concord it. When I take the prayer, sure, a word will come to my spirit and I'll write it. The lady went back to write examination and came out the best. If you desire to pray, you cannot live without one of these in your house. I have 12 prayer shows. And my prayer show, nobody has one. When I open them in portals, don't you see them? Nobody has one. It's given to me special by the rabbis. I told you something, I go to Israel 3 times in a year. Yeah. They brought few ones, get one. And after I bring it, let me sign it for you. Let it become a mantle. When this thing gets to your home, you see, I was the first time. Do you know why I pushed the rabbis to get us these prayer shows? When you go to Israel, there's a place they call the Muslims quarter and the Jewish. So I went there and I saw the prayer show was cheap and I bought one. I was standing there and a rabbi told me, say, Prophet, do you know what is written there? And I said, no. And he said, if you know the meaning of what they've written there, you will throw it away. It's more or less like a curse. I said, why? He said, because the Chinese people produce it. The Arabs go to China, produce it. But the prayer show, it's actually a Jewish thing. And you are not even permitted to use it until a rabbi pray over it. So we get it from the rabbis. They provide, we give it to people. For instance, this one I cannot sign it because if I sign, nobody can see. But the one that we bring specially. Get one in your house. The only reason Rahab's house didn't come down is that there was a mantle there. Don't leave your house. Now listen. Why do you see Rosalie and Tarismas and things in people's cars? And you don't have anything. It's not a decoration. Some of you want something wrong in your house and you are asleep, there's nothing to respond. No. All these mantles we are going to give to you, when you get to your house, your story will change. Yeah. Get the oil, some direct from Israel. Get it. Get some things. Some of these things, this mantle, say, even in London, it was a fight. By the way, I'm seeing you people, I'm not too sure. Maybe from here, we have to pass to London and still give it to the people in London because these people. You know, these things, they have gone through 70 days of fasting. Was it 50 or 50? And then 24, spiritual foundation was 24 days. And they just ended dominion is what? 14 days. So this mantle has even so prayer than the one we share at 50 days. More prayer. And do you know what we wrote there? God gave us to us. Stepping into generational blessing. So this one there, it delivers you from fighting your father's battles and your mother's battles or your army and your grandfather's battles and your grandmother's battles. And for your information, those of us who travel around, I have the Portis one. I have American one. I have UK one. I'm coming to have the European one. And finally, I will have the Canadian one. So you can imagine. So me, I can't be a local champion. Tell your neighbor, the levels are not the same. I have some daughters here. When they get this, they have four. And they are collecting it too. And you see my own, I've written inside. London. Portis. U.S. Today I'm going to write European stroke Switzerland. Sunday, if you want, I finish getting it. Lift up your feet. All garments are not the same. All lands are not the same. So get one. Get one. Get what? By the shores. Make sure. Amen. Mm-hmm. I want to give some people envelope, a lot of cost on this thing, to sow a seed of just 200 euros as an offering. Amen. I anoint this envelope for their financial. It's just an offering. Bless you, my dear.
If you can, do it.
I see some amazing sons and daughters here. I love, wherever I go, I see them. And their faces give me confidence to preach. This is what I call the international team.
Thank you.
In you alone. There are people here.
I make
why? Your bank account is closed.
You
have to help. The only way to encourage us to come back is that all the bills are paid. This is not special. And it's
thank
just
you, Dad. Free.
If you can give more than what I mentioned.
And the captain of my destiny. In you alone, I make my bones. You reign alone.
Yes, I'm waiting for you. If you are coming, tell your neighbor, let God speak to you. There is more blessings in giving than receiving. How do we call the money here? Oh, Swiss francs. Is it a good money?
Very heavy.
Bless you, sir. Now, if you fix your money, come and put it at the altar and talk into your financial blessing. Take it. Sorry? So put it inside and put it there.
Thank you.
Hey. That's my girl all the way from California. I'm looking for a husband for her. I have found three. I find two importers and one in London. I'm vetting the guys. I have some daughters here. I want a good man to marry them. Bless you, mommy. Yes, mommy. God bless you. Some of you have some 100 francs or 100. Give it. Bless you. I can see. Yes. Your prayers are answered. Agnes, that 100. Give it. You'll be blessed. A lot has gone into this particular meeting. something to show. Don't say that, okay? You are blessed.
Yes.
Amen.
How do you say thank you in French? Is it merci beaucoup? Is it merci? Giving will be invested.
Amen.
What we do is that whenever we go, we don't take anything out there. You see, you have an account here, World Prayer Center. What is the name of the bank? Huh? Post Finance Limited. Everything stays here. So that next time when we come, amen. We took seed from Ghana, changed it into euro to invest into this place. Yes. Believe in the investment of the kingdom. If your seed is ready, just come to the altar and put it there. The rest, everybody take an offering.
Amen.
And give us a song. Do you dance in this place? All right, take an offering. Even if you give a special seat, give you an offering. Stand to your feet. Give us a song. When you finish and you buy the show, when you come here, I'll take some 10 minutes and I'll sign it for you. Father, we ask for your blessing over the seat in Jesus' name. Amen. Those of you watching me in London, if you couldn't get the prayer show, get somebody who came from UK to buy you one so that when you come, you pay for it. All right. In Jesus' name, give us a song.
To the house of the Lord, we bring sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring sacrifice of praise of the Lord, and we offer unto you the sacrifices of thanksgiving. As we offer unto you the sacrifices of praise. The house of the Lord, as we offer unto you the sacrifices of thanksgiving, as we offer unto you the sacrifices.
Oh, can you stand to your feet for just 1 minute? We are closing.
Offer unto you the sacrifices of praise. We offer unto you the sacrifices of
praise. All right. I have to close. Pastor Martin and those who lead the prayer, I really want you to pray for a revival over this land. At least spend not less than 30 minutes doing that. And those of you in your room, just pray that God will remember Europe.
Amen.
Sometimes because I'm on air, it's not everything I can say prophetically. But there are places that when revival breaks forth, it will help the whole world. Because too much decisions are made from that place. So let's pray that here, Amsterdam, Germany, France, revival will break forth in the Schengen. Amen. Well, we have some great men of God and women who have traveled. Like I said, this evening I'm going to introduce them, but Reverend Chris Wilson Andor and his wife, Mrs. Andor, they are here. All the way from United Kingdom. Hallelujah. I think the wife has been followed from Bidding Power. If you see Bidding Power breed, then I'm going to call the woman of God, Pastor Frida, to pray. He is the engine behind all the amazing woman of God. I mean, my family and I has fallen in love with her. I mean, I just like simplicity. I just like simplicity, and she's been very instrumental. We have gone back and forth for the past about 3 years or thereabout, trying to, sometimes you get it and I'll cancel, and finally God has used her to put a lot of things together. Amen. And so I'm going to ask her to say hello to you and then pray for us and close us. Let's welcome the Reverend Frida, the man of God. God, richly, richly. Please clap better for her. If it's not her, you will not be.
Clap your hands, all you people. Hallelujah. The Bible says, shout to God with a voice of triumph.
Hallelujah. If you know that you have come to the living God, if you know that you have come to your Savior, if you know that you have come to the great I Am, the Ancient of Days, the Rock of Ages, the I Am that I Am, then lift up your voice and give the Lord a shout. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! It looks like a dream. Hallelujah! Just like God said in Psalm 127, when God turned the captivity of Zion around, it was like a dream to them. Hallelujah. But the people said, they are rejoicing, for God has done a great thing for them. Has God done something for you? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you so much, Prophet Nanasei. I met him in 2019. And our spirit just connected. Hallelujah. He's a man of God I love so much. I cherish him and his family. And my perception for God has changed. Hallelujah. My way of prayer has changed since I connected to this great man of God. Put your hands together and say, Papa, we love you. Papa, we love you. Hallelujah. Just as he said, a lot of resources has gone into this meeting. Amen. All the instruments you are seeing here were purchased. Hallelujah. And therefore, may God stir our hearts in this land. Hallelujah. To give unto God. Hallelujah. Let it be a point of contact for God to perform that miracle. For you cannot leave this place the same as you came. Something must change. Hallelujah. Lift up your hands with me. Father, we thank you, O God. We bless your name this afternoon. We have come to the great I am, our soon coming King. Our God is mighty. For among the gods that are mentioned in the heavens, those in the underworld, even those in the water body, those on the earth, who can be likened unto him? He alone is glorious in holiness, and he alone is fearful in praises. And therefore, this afternoon, we cast our crowns at his feet, and we say, Lord God, you are good, and your mercies endureth forever. We thank you for the purpose for which you have brought your servant into this land. Nothing happens by accident. Nothing happens by chance. For before the foundations of the earth, you have ordained for Switzerland to receive your choice servant at such a time as this. We say, Lord, thy kingdom come and thy will be done in our midst. In the name of Jesus, let the gates of the city of Geneva lift up your head. Let the King of glory come in, the one that is strong and mighty in battle. He is the Messiah. He is the breaker that breaks open the gates. We declare that the gates are open. May the city receive the anointing and the calling of Prophet Nanasei into this land. May the land respond in the name of Jesus. As he stands to minister, Lord God, may there be a revival. Let the wind begin to blow. Let it move across this nation. Let it move to all the European nations, that once again they will recognize that Jesus Christ, he alone is God. We thank you, Father, for that which you have in store for the rest of the time we have here. Be exalted in our midst. Be glorified. We thank you, even in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Invite somebody for tonight. Amen. Don't come alone, and come quickly, because I can assure you all the chairs will be filled. Amen. God bless you.